Hello, let's get started. Does that work? Yeah, it does. Good. Okay. So welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming to this session. I'm the CTO of Quobyte. My name is Felix Hupfeld. It's my pleasure to introduce you to Yusuke and Akira of Yahoo Japan. Who will share their basically experiences and plans of building a large scale OpenStack infrastructure. You're probably not aware of it, but maybe guessing from the name, Yahoo is one of the biggest internet service companies in Japan and basically serving the whole country. And that is basically also the scale that their infrastructure is at. And you'll get, I think, a lot of insights of what's relevant to run infrastructure at that scale. So please help me introduce or welcome Yusuke and Akira.
Thank you, Felix. Hello, my name is Yusuke Sato, and I'm an infrastructure engineer from Yahoo Japan. And I'm responsible for private cloud compute and storage. And this is Akira Kamio. He is OpenStack engineer, especially for hypervisor and software storage. Today, we will talk about our challenges of infrastructure and software storage. Let's start with the introduction of our company. Yahoo Japan is one of the largest internet companies in Japan. And we have many services, for example, search engine, e-commerce, mail, news, finance, and more. There are over 100 services. And our services are used by over 80% of Japanese internet users. This is our data centers. We have several data centers in Japan, and we also have one data center in the United States. And we are operating over 75,000 physical servers and over 120,000 virtual machines. And our storage systems all had over 60 petabyte capacity in total. These pictures are showing one of our server rooms in the Japan and the United States. In our environments, many services are running on our private cloud systems. Basically, our private cloud systems are OpenStack clusters. And now, we are starting to use Kubernetes as one of the platform of our services. Our Kubernetes clusters are running on OpenStack VMs and bare metal servers managed by Ironic. We have over 17 OpenStack clusters and so many instances, as I told. These clusters are operated by less than 20 engineers. To operate clusters of this scale, we have to reduce operational costs. We are working toward automation and improving efficiency. For example, cluster provisioning is automated by Chef, and we developed a chatbot and we can take some actions through the chat. Also, we have the centralized system logs and metrics. This makes us monitor and visualize it through the single dashboard. This is our challenge to make operation more efficient. And next, I'd like to talk about our storage complexity. We have many private cloud clusters, and we also have many storage systems. These storage systems are dedicated to each cluster and operated independently. That is inefficient to operate. Our challenge was to reduce storage operational costs. And this is the transition to software-defined storage. Today, we are mainly using storage appliance because that is capable of standing a heavy workloads and high availability. But it's expensive and it's not flexible. So we are testing software-defined storage. Software storage can run on commodity hardware, so it is more flexible and scalable. We tried to use SDS from 2 years ago. So we tested some software storages. Then we choose Qobyte as STS. Why we choose Qobyte? Most important thing is reducing operational costs. So Qobyte is a unified storage system. We can use Qobyte as a backend of object storage, Cinder block storage, and Manila file storage, and Kubernetes persistent volume. So it will reduce storage complexity of our system, and it will lead to easier to operate. How can we use Qobyte as multi-storage backend system? Qobyte cannot speak multi-storage protocol like block and object. It is only file storage. I will explain about these behaviors. First, about OpenStack Manila, this is simple. Qobyte volumes are created by user requests via OpenStack Manila API. Then virtual machines mount directly as file storage. Qobyte provides two methods to mount the volumes. They are NFS and Qobyte Native Client Protocol. Qobyte Native Client Protocol is based on Hughes. And if you use NFS, virtual machines mount Qobyte volumes through Qobyte NFS proxy service. Next, about OpenStack Cinder. This is like Cinder NFS driver. Qobyte volumes are mounted by hypervisors as file storage through Qobyte Native Client. Files are created on Qobyte volumes and mapped to VM instance as block device via QM. There are slight performance overhead compared with direct block attach, but we can handle these Cinder volumes as file. It is easy to operate. Next, Qobyte as object storage. Qobyte has S3 proxy service. It allows hybrid access to Qobyte file system through S3 protocol. Each virtual machine has access to S3 proxy server. And we can use OpenStack Keystone for user authentication. Finally, I'd like to talk about persistent volume for Kubernetes. As Kubernetes already has a plugin to integrate Qobyte volume as a persistent volume. Qobyte volume are mounted by Kubernetes nodes natively. Pods can access Qobyte volumes as read-write many persistent volumes. Next, I'd like to explain about our current status of introducing Qobyte to our private cloud. We already released a Qobyte cluster for Kubernetes persistent volume. This Kubernetes cluster is small and beta. So far, so good. And now, we are building two Qobyte clusters for OpenStack Cinder and Manila. These clusters are large scale and require high performance, so we are designing system configuration carefully. These configuration details will be described later. Before about our system configurations and benchmark results of Qobyte, I'd like to talk about challenges of introducing and operating STS in general. These challenges are true not only of Qobyte. We tested and operated some software-defined storage until now, but we think STS is still harder to operate the storage appliance for now. Because STS is not matured yet, on this point, Qobyte also has some bugs, but they fixed quickly and carefully. That was a good point. This is one reason why we choose Qobyte. But we think difficulty point of SDS is caused by SDS is a type of distributed system. For appliance storages, internal traffics like rebuild and regenerate traffics, control packets of each node go through high-speed interconnect or backplane. But for distributed systems, massive traffics are occurred on Ethernet as east-west traffic. So we need to have high bandwidth, high availability, and low latency network. We understood that network is most important piece of for SDS through the past experience operating some SDS products. Then we designed system configuration and monitoring carefully. Our configuration is designed for high bandwidth network for massive east-west traffic. These details will be touched later. And we set up network monitoring especially for distributed system. We are monitoring error count of NICs and ping latency of each node. We referred to a paper of Ping Mesh that is written by Microsoft. It is used for Azure. This is simple and effective monitoring methods for distributed system. If you are interested in it, please check a paper. These figures on this slide show the meshed ping monitoring of normal status and error status. All nodes ping each other, and each point is results of ping latency. Green point is normal status, and red point is high latency. Right figure is shown one node error. If network switch is broken, more red points were shown in the figure. So we can find abnormal network status much faster. So now I'd like to hand over to Akira Kamio here. He will take about details of configurations and benchmark results.
I will explain our Cobalt cluster we are now building. This is our system overview. Storage nodes and compute nodes are under closed networks. This is our server configurations for storage nodes and compute nodes. Each storage node has the dedicated NVMe JBOF. The JBOF provides 15 NVMe drives to each storage node. Compute nodes only have SATA SSD for boot. This slide is showing the singular configuration. I will explain how application workload goes and how the Cobalt server to Cobalt client traffic and server to server traffic goes for each. This is application traffic. This network is only used by QM processes. Physically, this is the single 25 gig Ethernet port and not redundant. Next, this is server to client traffic of Cobalt storage. Compute nodes have 25 gig Ether single pass. Storage nodes have 50 gig BPS bandwidth. It is configured MRAG with two physical 25 Ether ports. Network bandwidth between compute nodes and storage nodes almost equals to accessing the local NVMe drives. This is server to server traffic of Cobalt storage. Storage nodes have 50 gig BPS link with 225 gig Ether configured MRAG. Next, we will touch on the connection between storage node and JBOF. The bandwidth between network to host have 15 gigabps, and the connection host to JBOF is 16 lanes PCIe Gen 3 bus. This means the bandwidth is 31 gigabps. This is better for performance because network bandwidth is much larger than JBOF bandwidth. Now, I will talk about the system configurations, but I think you are concerned about performance. This is our test environment. Sage nodes and compute nodes are as described in this slide. This test environment has 18 storage nodes and 70 compute nodes. We use FIO as benchmark tool. The benchmark pattern are sequential and random read write with several performance of block size. This is read I/O performance from single client node. We compared the performance accessing to covert volume with local NVMe drive. Covert sequential I/O is lower than local NVMe. This is shown on the right side, this graph. But Covert has better performance at random I/O with over 128 gig block size because Covert is distributed system. So we think Covert has good performance even if compared with local NVMe drive. This is light I/O. Covert sequential I/O is also lower than local NVMe, but Covert has much better performance at almost random I/O patterns. This is multi-node read I/O performance of whole Covert cluster. Peak read I/O PS is over 1,000 K I/O PS. Peak I/O, peak read bandwidth is over 40 gigabytes per second. It has much better performance than our legacy storage system. This is light I/O. Peak light I/O PS is over 300 K I/O PS. Peak light bandwidth is over 20 gigabytes per second. It is also more than what we expected. And this slide is showing how much impact on read write performance comparing healthy Covert cluster with the cluster has single node down. The graph is showing read I/O is 16% down at worst, and light I/O is 30% down at worst. But in most patterns, there are not so many differences between the healthy cluster and the degraded cluster. Next feature work. We are still waiting for better cluster configuration regarding network architecture. We think that MLAG and LAG are not happy because it results to have vendor lock-in and have huge L2 network. We will try to new configurations. For example, server-side L3 on closed network and 100 gigabit Ethernet network. Currently, storage nodes have redundant paths using MLAG. This is what we think about the future cluster network architecture. Each storage node has BGP client and exchange the root talking BGP. We think this is more simple architecture than using MLAG. Also, the way to make current configuration more simple is using 100 gigabit Ether without redundancy. The advantage of this configuration is making cabling simple. However, it has the advantage that node will go down in case of single switch failure from storage system perspective. As I described it, in terms of performance-wise, we got the confidence to use Cobyte in our production. But regarding cluster network configuration, we are now still working on to find out what the best is. Finally, I'd like to summarize our presentation. First, Cobyte is unified storage. This means single Cobyte cluster can be the backend for multiple OpenStack components, which are Cinder, Manila, and Object Storage. This makes our operational cost much lower. Second, and Cobyte has much better performance than our legacy storage system. And finally, regarding support on evaluation phase, we got some software bugs, but the support team provided fix patch pretty fast, and they worked well. This makes us have strong confidence to introduce Cobyte to our production system. Yeah. Thank you for attention.
Are there any questions? Be happy to take them, please. Why didn't you pick Ceph?
we are also using Ceph in not production environment, but I think Ceph is not so stable, and Cobyte is more stable than Ceph.
So there's a performance graph, and there was one basically with one queue there. No, it was with one block size, it was above 100%. And he's wondering why it gets faster when there's a node gone. In the end, I guess you have measurement variability anyway, and so they're not taking into account the confidence interval. So I guess that's. In the end, if you put that in production, you over-provision anyway, and so you're having this variability is there, and I think the graph should show that it's mostly not taking too much impact.
some major storage vendors. Maybe you know.
Maybe you can say if it's a block or files, is it NAS or SAN?
File storage.
So it's a
major. We are mainly using very major NAS storage vendor.
Do we have more questions? Otherwise, both Yahoo Japan and we are present. We also have a booth in the exhibition hall and can come up anytime and for more questions. So thank you very much.